Well, good morning. How are you all?
Good.
Thank you for braving the cold weather and the activities downtown and coming this morning. Welcome. My name is Troy. I'm one of the pastors here. Grateful to have you join us in person. Also, all you are watching online. I'm going to make my predictions. I am not like my wife. I believe in the Chiefs today, man. It's a just, you know, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years have taught me something about Mahomes and all that. And speaking of which, Julie and I, we've just been busy with all the things that are going on around the church. We didn't make any plans for Super Bowl party. So if you're doing one, we are available. We're free agents and we'd love to come over. We won't bring our stupid cowboy jerseys because I burned them, you know, I threw them away. So anyway, but good to see you. Thank you for being here on Super Bowl Sunday. And I also want to just give a shout out to all of you. Thank you for volunteering last night and going down and helping our community. It was a lot of fun serving with you, and really, really neat to do that. And then lastly, so much stuff has happened in our church. I don't get a chance to always keep up with all the good things, but last weekend we held a little fundraiser for our Cuba mission that we're doing. We have about 20 people that are going next week down to Cuba, working with our friends in Bolindrone, Cuba, and we raised, with that little fundraiser, about $15,000 for those folks, man. That is like $1 million to those folks. That's going to help a lot, and so I thank Marco and his team and all of you for being a part of that. So we are continuing our series this morning through the book of Ruth. It's a little book that's tucked away in the early part of the Old Testament. And today we're shifting gears a little bit. We're going to see and watch as Ruth and Boaz get to know each other. And we're going to see how they begin to date and how they begin to learn about each other in possible preparation for a marriage that will hopefully and will, you'll see in the story, honor God. Now, we're doing this in recognition of Valentine's Day is this week. If you didn't know, I'm here to help you. Valentine's Day is this week, and so we're going to be talking about dating and marriage and love this morning. I want to start off with dating. I'm going to ask you a quick question. I'm sure you'll agree with me. Isn't dating kind of awkward? Raise your hand if you think dating's a little awkward. Some of you are like, I haven't done it for 20 years. I don't even think about it. But it is. It's awkward. It's a little like a job interview. You go, you don't know what to wear. You don't know what to say. You don't really know how to act. I mean, it's really tough. And I think for me, dating, one of the most awkward parts about going on a date is how do you end the date? You ever thought about that? How do you do it? I mean, shaking hands isn't probably the best thing. Good job. See you later. Don't do that, right? Or, you know, what do you do? I mean, I need some single people. Do you bump knuckles? You know, or do you remember the Christian side hug? You know, you don't touch. You kind of stick your butt out. And you kind of, goodbye, good night. You guys don't like that, huh? Take a picture. Enjoy. Whatever. How about, or do you give them a kiss? On the cheek, you know, act like it's some, you're from France or something like that. No big deal. Or do you go for some tonsil hockey on that first date? Come on. No, all right. Inappropriate. I'm sorry. Yeah. When I was dating, as you can imagine, it was really awkward because I'm awkward, but it was really awkward back then because you had to talk face-to-face to somebody. You had to, I like you a lot. You know, you had to kind of talk to them in face or on your phone. But nowadays, people date online, and that's interesting. It's a little impersonal, but don't get me wrong. I've met a lot of great couples who have met online, but it just feels, like I said, a little impersonal. You search for somebody online. You meet them online. You have your first several conversations online. It's just kind of like going shopping. You know, you're just kind of shopping. You got your little profiles and your stats that you put out and the things that you're looking for and you want. And it's just a lot of conversation about this is the kind of person that I'm looking for. I want this and this and this. And that's tough. And of course, you ladies, you don't ask for a lot, do you? You don't need much in a date. You just want him to be handsome. You know, you want him to be attractive and funny. And also have a job, right? And gainful employment's good. And you want him to be strong, yet sensitive, right? You want that. You want to be handsome, but humble, right? You want a guy who will share his dessert with you at the end of the meal, right? He'll share it with you, but then he'll also go to gym every day, right? And of course, what you want is he's got to like pina coladas and taking long walks in the rain, amen? Yeah, and watching The Notebook at least once a year. You guys don't need a lot, right? Just that's all you want, right? You're not talking to me. I don't care. I'm going to preach a sermon whether you like it or not this morning. So if you missed last week, we are going through the book of Ruth, and it is a story about a Moabite widow who left Moab, left everything that she had, and she went up to Bethlehem. She left her old way of life and her old God, and she started following the God of Israel. And everything began to change for her for the better that moment that she made that decision. And this week, what we're going to do is we're going to watch as Ruth, the widow from Moab, gets to know Boaz. Everybody say Boaz. You don't want a broke ass. You don't want a dumb ass. You want a Boaz. Amen. We're going to watch as Ruth, the widow from Moab, gets to know Boaz, the man of standing from Bethlehem. And we're going to watch them come together and get together, and we're going to see some principles, some thoughts that can help you date wisely if you're in that game, or these will strengthen your marriage as well. These will help your marriage. And I hope that you kind of enjoy this week. We're just going to have fun. It's going to be very practical. It's going to be a little goofy. But next week, I warn you, it's going to be weird and it's going to be hard. But don't miss it. It's going to be helpful. But today, I want to just have fun. So here's the first principle that I want you to think about when it comes to relationships. Instead of just looking for what you want to find in a person, I would suggest to you that you look for what you want to give to a person. Instead of looking for that quality that you want to find in someone, you think about what you want to give someone. Why is that so important? Because here's a little truth that maybe you never thought about. You don't always attract what you want. You attract what you are. You don't always get what you want in this thing. What you'll get is who you basically are. You get what you want. And we see this play out in today's story. Today, we're going to see four signs that you might actually have a keeper. Four signs that you might have one that's good for you and that you'll keep if you're dating. And if you're married, you might decide that you want to trade up. So pay attention here, all right? Boaz is checking Ruth out, and Ruth is checking Boaz out. And the first thing that they're doing, they see, is both of them are doing this. They are seeking, and this is number one, they are seeking character. They're looking for someone with character. Secondly, they're exploring connection, right? There's a process here. Thirdly, they are showing consideration to one another. And lastly, they are receiving confirmation. Now, did you notice that there are four C's in this? And you know this, a sermon is always more anointed when the preacher uses words that start with all the same letters, right? So you know you're in for a good one today. So here we go. Seeking character, exploring connection, sowing consideration, and receiving confirmation. Let's break these down one by one by going through the story. First of all, before I jump in the story, let me give you a little context. Last week, we were introduced to Boaz as a man of standing, which means that he was a man of integrity. He had a faith in God. He's living principles. He's a man of wealth and means, okay? That's what it means. Ruth was taken aback by his kindness and his generosity to her. Now, you listen to that story, you might assume that the reason he was kind and generous was to her because she was a hottie, right? But that's not what the text says. The text doesn't say anything about her appearance. We don't know if she was beautiful or not. It's not in there. What we do see is that the text hints that it was something else that attracted Boaz to her. In verse 10, after he offered her this meal, she'd been working all day, he offered her a meal. It says this, that at this, after the meal, she bowed with her face down to the ground, and she asked Boaz a question. She said, "Why have I found such favor in your eyes that you notice me, a foreigner, someone who is from the wrong side of the tracks? I'm from Moab. I shouldn't even be here. Why would you even notice me?" And Boaz's answer is revealing. It shows that he wasn't just looking at her looks. He was looking at what was on the inside. He was looking at her character. Listen to what he says. Verse 11, it says, Boaz replied, I have been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. I know that you're a widow, and I've heard how you left your father and your mother and your homeland, and you came to live with a people that you did not know before. In other words, I heard that you left Moab. You moved to Bethlehem, and I heard that you stopped worshiping that false god Chemosh, right? And that you've now decided to follow the God of Israel. I've seen that you are loyal to your mother-in-law and that you're not acting like a victim, like this happened to you and it's out of control and that someone owes you someone and you're not waiting for someone to come and save you. Instead, you got up early this morning and you went out and you've been working hard to pull yourself out of this hole and you're not selling your body like everyone else would, like widows often did back in the day. Instead, you are honoring God. Ruth, I can see that you are a person of character, that there's more to you going on in the inside than maybe someone would know. I want that. I like that. Here's a serious question for you this morning. You might want to ask yourself this. Are you a person of character? Do you have character? I'm not talking about, yeah, I'm a Christian, right? I've always been a Christian. I was born in the United States of America. That makes me a Christian, right? And I believe in God. You know, every now and then I do something godly. You know those kind of people? We all have met people who identify as Christian, but the truth is that they're not really following Jesus in their life. They're not following in his ways, right? They're out bar hopping on Saturday night, and occasionally they show up at church. Doesn't work for them on Saturday night. They hopefully find someone here. Or maybe they're dating people and they're going from bed to bed to bed and they're wondering, why isn't God helping me find a good spouse, right? Are you a person of good character? Well, why does it matter, Pastor Troy? It matters, and here's why. Are you a good person of good character now? Are you seeking to make yourself a person of good character now? Because it matters because you can't, listen to me, you can't build a life of righteousness on a foundation of sin. I know for a long time I just thought, well, I can do all this now, and then one day I'm going to put it together, and I'll have everything that I want. No. You can't build a life of righteousness and God's blessing in your life on a pile of sin that you've been doing. And so if you want a godly marriage someday, you would do good by seeking and following God today, right? That would be good for you. And so are you a person of spiritual character? What does that mean? Well, very simply, Jesus said it means loving God and loving people. That you are a person that is loving God, you're learning who God is, and you're learning how he works, and you're learning his ways. You know, do you let God's word, do you read God's word? And secondly, do you let God's word change you? Are you just reading it, or are you thinking, oh my gosh, I've got to course correct. This is what God has for me. Are you a person that just goes to church? Or are you actually serving at your church, doing something, being involved? Are you learning to be generous? Are you learning that as you walk with Jesus, there's just something better about giving than receiving? Or are you still focused on building and creating your own little kingdom, your own little pile versus his? Now, I'm not saying that you need to be perfect. I'm not asking if you're perfect. I'm just asking, are you allowing God day by day to perfect you as you follow Jesus, the only perfect one? Here's my big point. You should be looking for a person of character. You should be looking for someone that has character. Yes, they should be attractive to you. Yes, but do they have character? How do you know? Well, pay attention. Watch how they treat people. Watch how they treat your friends and their friends. How do they treat your family and their family? Pay attention to that. Are they disconnected from their parents? They're like, oh yeah, well, I can't talk to them. Or their siblings, oh my brother, or their even their own children. Are they pay attention to that. Pay attention to how they treat regular people that they encounter, like waiters or waitresses. How kind are they to them, right? Do they have a heart to serve others? Do they have a heart to help others? Or is their first instinct, man, I gotta do something, and then they do it. What are their friends like? Pay attention to that. What are those guys and gals like? Do they have any Christian friends? Do they have anybody that knows the Lord and is following the Lord and is kind of connected to them, right? Do they distract you from pursuing God? Are they pulling you back from God or are they pushing you towards? Are they running towards God and encouraging you to keep up? Or are they pulling you back, right? Are they pushing you sexually? Are they wanting to go a little bit beyond? My friend, those are signs that the person might not have good character, that they have not drawn lines in their own life, and that they have boundaries. Wise old pastor once told me, he said, when a person shows you who they really are, believe them. When a person shows it, people tell you all the time, but when a person shows it, you ought to go, you know what, mental note, I'm paying attention to that. And so here's Boaz, who is a man of character, and he quickly notices that Ruth has good character. And the next thing that we see them doing is exploring connection. Now, there's all kinds of ways, of course, in dating and relationships that we can have connection. But what I'm talking to you about is that they're looking to see if there's a genuine, deep connection, a spiritual, emotional connection. And they're not doing it like a lot of people do it nowadays, you know. I talked about this last week. People kind of find connection. They slide into each other's DMs and say, hey, want to come over and watch some Netflix and chill? You guys apparently don't know what that means. Do you guys know what that means? Ask your teenager. They'll tell you. Or hey, want to meet up at the club and do a little bump and grind on the dance floor? That's how people are doing it. That's not what happens here. Boaz invites her out on a lunch date. How sweet. How gentle, how kind, how safe. It's a simple way for him to get to know her. At verse 14, it says this. At mealtime, halfway through the day, as she was working, Boaz said to her, hey, come over here. Have some bread. Dip it into the wine vinegar. And when she sat down with the harvesters, he offered her some roasted grain. And she ate all she wanted and had some left over. This is consideration. This woman is a widow. She's been eating dirt for who knows how long. And this man blesses her, and blesses her with an abundance. Now, what's interesting here is that Ruth doesn't do what a lot of women do. She doesn't move too fast in the relationship. She doesn't say, hey, thanks for the nice meal. So tell me, what are you looking for in a wife? You want to have kids? How many kids? I have some names picked out. You want to talk about it? Don't do that. This is just the first date. Take it slow. And they're taking it slow. They're not out making out. They're not fooling around. They're not playing naked twister or whatever that is. You guys remember the game Twister? You spin it, right hand on blue, you know. Sorry, that was awkward. Anyway, they're not doing that. They're just talking, and they're getting to know each other. And I would suggest to you as a pastor, I see this often. So often nowadays, relationships move to the physical way too soon. Way too soon. And I would encourage you not to make that mistake, whether you're an adult or a young person. The principle is true. Let the friendship grow. Get to know each other. Find out what you have in common. Share your hopes and your dreams with each other. You know, the physical part is the easiest part of all. That doesn't take... This is easy. Just trust me. I know this is, again, awkward. I can't help it. I'm a child. Whatever. But that's the easy part. Getting to know and making a connection. Ladies, my point is what you want is you want a man to put some effort in connecting with you intellectually and emotionally. You need to see that he's interested in that and that he's working hard to make that happen. He's putting some effort. That's a good sign. Back in the 80s when I was dating, that's a long time ago, so I know I don't talk about it. But back in the 80s, man, if you dated a girl, the first thing you had to do is you had to make a mixtape. You guys remember this? Yeah, this was back in the day before you could listen to any song that had ever been made for $7.99 a month on your iPhone. Before that happened, you had to have a dual cassette boombox so that you could make mixtapes for your girlfriends. This is true. There was a process, and this is how the process worked. You would sit around all day long on a Saturday listening to the radio. You had your cassette on pause, and you'd wait and wait and wait, and finally they'd play a song you'd like, and you'd hit record as quick as you could, and you'd capture it on that tape. And then later on, you'd get all the best songs of that, and you would record it onto another tape, right, a mixtape, and then you would give that to her. And this mixtape was a way for you to express your heart for the girl that you were dating. And this process took hours upon hours to finish. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? This is hard. And then what you'd do is you'd give her the tape, or better yet, you would play it for her. You would say, hey, let's just hang out on the porch and listen to this thing that I put together. And you'd pull out your little Walkman. Remember a Walkman? And you'd have little two cords, and you'd have a headphone for her, and you're listening. And then you would push play, and you would start off. You would start off with something fun and light, right? Just ease into it. Don't get too heavy, too deep. You know, let them know. Ha, 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 ha. Little wham. And then, you know, then you'd begin to kind of peel back, you know, and show your heart. You know, you'd maybe play a little Air Supply. Come on. Come on, yeah. Just open it. Maybe slow dance with her. Come on. Got your headphones on. But so many ways. Come on, everybody. Yeah, you got your flashlight on that. But again, you got to ease it, and then you're working, and you're trying to crescendo, and of course, you lay down the big one, Journey, right? Steve Perry. Come on, everybody. Yeah. You feel the mood? Go ahead, put your arm around her right now. So, okay, I got me. So you do that, and that's how you would connect with her. And this is what we had to do to connect with the women back in the day. This is what we had to do to woo these gals. My point is, guys, put a little effort into it. Put a little effort into connecting with her emotionally, intellectually. Think of ways spiritually. Invite her to your church, for God's sake. That's a win. Bring her to your church. Ask her, what do you think of my pastor? Yeah, I agree. That little comment about twister sex or whatever is a little odd. Just overlook that. But that's what they did. I love that. So seek character, explore connection, relational, emotional connection. And then next, we see them showing consideration. We see them being kind to one another. This is something that you would want in a prospective spouse or mate. Verse 15, it says this, that as Ruth got up from the meal to go back out and glean, we'll talk about that in a second, Boaz gave orders to his men, let her gather among the sheaves. In other words, she doesn't have to hang out behind the harvesters. She can get right there in the mix of it. And don't reprimand her. Why don't you even pull out some stalks of grain for her from the bundles and leave them for her to pick up, and don't rebuke her for doing so. What's happening here? Well, we talked last week about how in the book of Leviticus, God had commanded the children of Israel that when they would do a harvest, that they would leave behind a little bit of grain for the poor. That if grain fell as they harvested, they would not stop and pick it up. They would leave it and allow the poor to come. And Ruth was a poor widow. She had nothing. And early in the morning, she went out to pick up some grain that had fallen on the ground. But after lunch with Boaz, Boaz tells his workers to leave a little bit more behind for her. I love this. He's helping her. He's helping her, but he's guarding her dignity. He's not giving her a handout. She's still having to work and to do that and have her dignity, but he is making it easier for her to get more. This is a great sign in a date that they're about giving more. He didn't just do enough. He didn't just do the bare minimum. He didn't just do what the law commanded. He went beyond the law. He's given her more than what he was obligated to do. And look at how this affected Ruth. In verse 17, it says, so Ruth gleaned in the field all the way until evening, and she then threshed the barley that she had gathered. And look at this. It amounted to about an ephah. Everybody say ephah. Ephah. What is that? Well, in the Hebrew, that is a lot of barley. Basically, it is 2 weeks' wages of barley. This woman worked for one day, but she walked away with 2 weeks' wages. Boaz blessed her with more. My point is very simple, gals and guys. Find someone who is considerate. Find someone who is generous. Find someone who is just loving life and enjoying life. Life is so much better, I have found, when you hang out with people who are generous. That's why I love this church. You guys are generous. Any opportunity we have to help or give or make someone's life easier, you guys are all over it like stink on a monkey. It blows my mind. And I love this church. And it's something that's attractive. In fact, I would suggest to you that generous people show God in a way that is undeniable. You cannot argue with generosity. I can debate with your philosophy. I can debate with your beliefs. But I cannot deny generosity. Many people may tell you that they love God, but their generosity shows you that they love God. It is undeniable. And it's something to look for in a person, that they have a generous, open heart. And I remember when I was dating Julie back in the early days and we started dating, Julie had a black Honda Prelude. She'd had it since high school. She'd moved out to California, went through college, had it. It had about 280,000 miles on it. It was crazy how many miles that car had on it. And I remember one evening she told me that she needed to get some work on it. She was taking it to a mechanic, and I knew this. Julie was a piano teacher. That was her job. She basically would drive and do private lessons with kids during the day, and she needed to get a car to get around. She didn't make much money off of it, but it was a living. And so I offered to loan her my car. I had a real nice car. I had a LeBaron. Also sexy in that black. You should have seen it. Anyway, so I gave her my car while hers got fixed, and she gratefully said thank you. And a day later, she brought it back to me. And then so I gave her a ride back so that she could pick her car up at the mechanic. And I'll never forget getting in that car and starting it. And I just happened to look down at the gas gauge, and I noticed that it was completely full. And I knew that I did not leave it to her completely. I knew there was some gas in it. It might have maybe half a tank. But it was full. And I thought about that. Julie, instead of just filling it back to maybe half or a quarter or wherever it was, she took it all the way to the top. And that little gesture made a big impression on me, and I proposed to her on the spot. I'm joking. I'm not that cheap, but it impressed me. Why? Because she didn't just meet my expectations. She didn't just take it back up to half, which is appropriate. That's right. She went all the way. She exceeded that. Ladies, find a man who exceeds your expectations. Find a man who exceeds the norm. He doesn't just do enough. And guys, be a person that puts a little effort into it. Go above and beyond. Man, don't be a slacker. Clean your car before you take her out on a date. I mean, throw the McDonald's wrappers out at least so it doesn't stick to her when she gets out. It's got cheese on her thigh and thinks a lot. You know, clean up the car. Get her a little gift. Make her a mixtape, for God's sake. Right? Every now and then, take her to a restaurant that doesn't have a drive-thru. How's that, right? Ask her questions about her life. Guys, if you want a Ruth, be a Boaz. Be a Boaz. If you want a good woman, be a good man. Be a giver. Be generous. Why? Because you don't attract what you want. You attract what you are. And Julie and I saw a generous heart in her, and our life together, we don't have discussions about money. We don't have debates about money. We always, when it comes to giving, I'll go, hey man, let's pray, and I'll pray. And we 100% always land on the same exact amount. And it's always a little bit more than maybe either of us would think. And we're never happy. I don't have to beg her, please, we go. She doesn't have to beg, please, Daddy Troy, can we give some money to the people in Cuba? Yes! That's our instinct. We lean into being generous and kind. This will help you. You don't like what I'm preaching. I don't care. I'm going to preach this all the way to the end, and we're getting there. All right, so they're seeking character. They're looking for connection, and they're showing consideration. And then they receive confirmation. They receive confirmation. And this is an important aspect of dating that many people unfortunately overlook. Some of you probably did. Ruth, think about this. Ruth comes home to her mother-in-law, and she has an ephah grain. And she's like, Naomi, look at this. Look at what I've got. And look at what her mother-in-law says in verse 19. Her mother-in-law asked her, Where did this come from? Where did you glean today? Where were you working? And then she says this, blessed is this man who took notice of you. Oh my gosh, this is not a typical dude. That is way beyond what anyone would expect. We were just hoping that someone would allow you to go and pick up the scraps. But this guy must be an honorable man. This guy must be a godly man. Whoever this guy is, I like him a lot. I love that. And that's one thing that we know about Naomi is that she loved Ruth. She had a heart for this young lady who stuck with her in her darkest time. Naomi lost her husband, her two sons. She had nothing, and Ruth stuck with her. And you might remember back in chapter 1, we see that heart exposed when Naomi prayed for Ruth. She prayed that God would bring kindness into her life, that God would bring her a good man into her life. She loved it. She was rooting for her. And so you have this woman who loves her and wants the best for her. And here she is confirming that this guy, this one, has potential. This guy might be a good candidate. There's some good things in here. That's an age-old practice of bringing your mate to meet your parents. This is wise. This is so wise. Bring him to your parents. This has been done for thousands of years. It was done back then. And you know what? It'll be being done for 1,000 years from today. It's a wise principle. It's a good thing. In fact, it's going to change a little bit. Our culture's changed so much, we might see this dynamic be different. In fact, I saw a video yesterday. I want to show you. Take a look at this. This is what's going to be like 4 years from now.
Real fast.
So, Mom, Dad, do you like him?
How many followers does he have?
Like 300-something.
That's a little low, honey.
So he's not an influencer? Who is he influencing?
His dog?
He probably only wants you for your followers.
That's not true.
I didn't want to say anything, but when they brought the food over, he didn't take any pictures, no videos, nothing. He just started eating like some animal.
Yeah, I saw that too.
What are his pronouns?
He, him.
Oh, God.
There it is. What are we supposed to tell a family?
How much Bitcoin does he make?
He makes regular money.
Okay, I'm done. That's it. I'm done. No.
You're hurting your father so much.
This is a good practice. My point is, don't get too distracted on it. It is almost, think about this, this is a good line. It is almost always a good sign when those who love you the most like who you like the most. That's usually a good sign. When your friends are like, I don't know. It's good when your peeps are like, you know what? I see potential in this one. This one might be a keeper. That's a good sign. And so the principle here is very simple. Take him or her to meet your family. Put them to the family dinner test. Get the whole family around, brothers and sisters, kids. We're going to sit and talk and watch how he or she acts. Do they engage with the family? Are they just kind of hiding out? Or do they express interest in each one of the family members, right? Watch that, right? Do they contribute to the conversation or are they just mumbling, right? Are they polite? I mean, notice that. Are they helpful? Do they get up and take their plate to the kitchen? That would be a good sign. Do they offer to help clean up? Ask your family, have the courage to ask your family, what do you guys think? I know it's a little scary, but my sense is that they may give you some good insight into that. And if you don't have a family or you don't have a healthy family, hopefully you have a Christian community of friends that are around you. Go to dinner with them. Ask them, what do you think? And of course, this can be tricky for them, but say, listen, I need your honesty. I'm evaluating. I know this isn't the final judgment, but tell me, what did you sense? And if they don't really like the person that you're dating, you know what? You would be wise to listen up. Don't get belligerent. Go, but I love him. You don't know her like I do, or I see so much more potential in them. Listen, you don't have to debate it. Just go, let me watch that, and I'll pay attention to that over the next few weeks and months and perhaps years. Be careful to listen to your people and get their perspective on that person, especially if you're engaged in premarital sex. Not quiet in this Catholic church. Everybody starts crossing themselves. But seriously, you should listen to your friends, especially if you're engaged in sex before marriage, because the Bible teaches that sex is a gift. And it should be protected and reserved for marriage. Why? Because it is powerful. It is powerful. It's not just a thing. It's not just a side thing. Anybody who has been sexually abused will tell you sex is powerful. It can bring harm. It's like fire. It can do a lot of good, but it can do a lot of harm, right? And in Proverbs chapter 5, God tells us that sex is intoxicating. Sex is intoxicating. It has a way of affecting your judgment and numbing some of your senses. In other words, premarital sex is like being drunk. Everybody looks better when you're drunk. Everybody looks better at closing time. People seem better when you're drunk. You're less aware of what's really happening to you when you're inebriated. And so I'm just going to read this right out as I wrote it. Relationally speaking, some of you might currently be drunk on sex and need to sober up before you end up in a relationship that feels like a hangover. Thank you, Pastor Troy. You're welcome. It's affecting your judgment, and you ought to be listening to your friends. And if your mom doesn't like them, and if your dad doesn't like them, and your brother doesn't like them, and your dog doesn't like them, you should pay attention to that. If your best friend doesn't like them, if your connect group isn't all that enamored, they may not be the best fit for you. Get confirmation from people around you. There is wisdom in the counsel of many. Amen. Thank you very much, man. Let's just get to the Super Bowl. Shut up and move along. All right. So, Ruth shows up to this first date. I said this was going to be fun. I lied. It's hard. Ruth shows up to this first date. She's sweaty and dirty. She's not looking her best. Her hair's a mess. She smells funky. And yet, Boaz sees through all of that. I love this. Boaz sees her character. He sees what she's made of. And he begins to seek ways to connect with her emotionally, intellectually. He wants to get to know her. He's knowing and learning her story. And he begins to show her consideration and being kind and generous. And she goes and gets confirmation from her friends and family that she's in the right ballpark here. And so, with those in mind, what if you're dating right now and you realize that ain't happening in your situation? Or what if you're married right now and you realize, I skip some of those things. And you're like, how can I get my marriage where it needs to be? What can I do? Either one of those, if you find yourself in that pickle, I want to let the text help answer your question. This is a great little passage. And this is a little peek into where we're going next week. So let me tell you the story. Ruth, remember, comes home from picking up and gleaning, and she says to her mother-in-law, look what I got. And Naomi is like, wow, who helped you get that? And she's like, Boaz. Everybody say Boaz. Boaz. And Naomi says this, Boaz is one of our relatives. He's related to us. He's connected to us. This is interesting. Verse 20, she goes further. She says, he, and I love this, is one of our guardian redeemers. Other translations say kinsman redeemers, guardian redeemers. What's a guardian redeemer? Well, this is a big theme of the book of Ruth, and we're going to get to it next week. And in many ways, it is a metaphor of the entire Bible. A guardian redeemer was something that God instituted. It was a relative whose role was to come in and help protect and help provide for a family member who had went through a tragedy or who had experienced a significant loss. God had created this safe, fail-safe way of helping someone who maybe lost a spouse and had no one in the world to help them. By law, the guardian redeemer would be required to come in and step in and help this person. Now, what's interesting in this story is that Boaz wasn't the actual guardian redeemer. There was actually a family member that was closer to them that was required and was by law should have done this. And that was, of course, Elimelech's brother was the one that was supposed to come in and help. But it looks like Boaz is making this move here. And not only that, as a Moabite, Boaz didn't owe Ruth anything. I mean, she was a foreigner. It was Naomi that his allegiance would have been to. And yet, here's the thing I don't want you to miss. He chooses to step in and begin to open his door and his heart to her. He begins to give her everything. And this wasn't the law. This was grace. And in the New Testament, if you haven't figured this out, you and I have a guardian redeemer. And his name is Jesus. Jesus is the Son of God who has come to protect us and provide for us. And he paid for all of our sins. He paid for our debt. All of our debt in full when he died on the cross. He is our guardian redeemer. He wants to redeem our lives. He's the one who works in all things to bring about good. He works in all things, even broken relationships, even in struggling marriages. And so no matter what you've done or where you've been or what you're up to now, if you're living together and you're like, man, we stepped too far. What do we do? How do we fix that? Or maybe you're struggling in your marriage, which happens on occasion. Or maybe perhaps you're healing from a divorce. You need to remember, you have a guardian redeemer whose goal is to come and redeem your life and to turn things around. And so no matter what you've done, there is no sin that is too great for God's grace. There's no marriage that is too broken for God's healing. And there is no relationship that is beyond God's redemptive power in your life. When two people begin to seek one God, things begin to change. I promise you that. And Jesus is our guardian redeemer, and he loves to redeem and renew the broken things in our life and wherever and whatever you're facing. So let me pray, and we'll get you home to the Super Bowl, but let God do some work right now. Father, I pray that you would help us to know you and to put you first in all that we do. To put you first, here these folks are, putting you first in their week, putting you first part of their day, putting you first in their work, in their finances, in their business, and putting you first in their relationships. And my sense is that there are a lot of people here who have a relationship and they want to pray for it. Maybe it's your parents' relationship and you see them struggling, you're worried about it. Or maybe it's a friend's relationship that you know about. Or maybe your kids are struggling right now. Or maybe it's your own relationship. I just pray that as we come to you, God, that we would remind ourselves that one of the reasons you sent your son into this world was to come and fix the broken things in our lives and to reconcile broken relationships. 2 Corinthians 5, Paul said that you sent your son to reconcile man back to God. And man back to man, and woman back to man, and man back to woman, and child back to father or mother. You are a specialist in redeeming broken things, and Jesus is our guardian redeemer. And when things begin to fall apart, he steps in and he helps. He steps in and redeems that which has been broken. And so today, this morning, God, whatever we're doing, whatever we're picking up the pieces from a broken relationship, we're trying to repair one, we're trying to hold on. We invite Jesus into all the broken things and broken relationships we have, and we invite him to come and help us to make all things good again. Help us to do that. Give us the courage. Show us how to forgive, God. Help us to get that bitterness and that hurt out and to forgive them as you have forgiven us. Give us the courage to offer grace to them instead of judgment. And help us to heal instead of hurt those that are in our lives, God. Father, help us also to know when it's time to move on, to get on up out of Moab, and to return back to you up in Bethlehem, Lord. Help us to do that, I pray, in Jesus' name. And if you agree with that, say amen. Amen. Hopefully that encouraged you and helped you.